Hello, my name is Frank Sedlar. I'm a recent graduate in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering here at the University of Michigan. And this fall, I'll be beginning a master's degree in the same department. I'm a recent winner of the M. Library Undergraduate Research Award for my paper, Engineering Industrial Architecture, Albert Kahn and the Trussed Concrete Steel Company, for which I received second place. This paper was the result of research for a class taught by Professor Claire Zimmerman through the architecture department. What initially drew me to Albert Kahn was his prominence on the University of Michigan's campus. Albert Kahn was an architect active in the early 1900s. A lot of his work was done here on the University of Michigan's campus. In fact, 19 buildings were done by Albert Kahn on Central Campus alone. And this was a time when the university, the regents of the university, were really trying to diversify the architecture style of the American institutions, kind of make it separate from what was happening in the Ivy Leagues, still with its influences from Europe. So what Albert Kahn did was really transition and develop a uniquely American institutional style, as evidenced by his numerous buildings here on the University of Michigan's campus. In particular, Hatcher Library, which I'm standing in front of. This was one of the many buildings on the campus designed by Albert Kahn. Other ones include Angel Hall, Hill Auditorium, the Burton Bell Tower, Clements Library, C.C. Little, as well as West Hall, to name just but a few of the many 19 buildings. To begin this research, I began asking the question, what really set Albert Kahn's designs apart? Aside from all of his work on the University of Michigan's campus, Albert Kahn is perhaps most well known for designing the early automotive factories for the likes of Henry Ford, the Packard brothers, General Motors. And it was with these modern daylit factories that he really became known and subsequently contracted to design on the University of Michigan's campus. These factories, which he really pioneered, transitioned from heavy mill-type construction, which had dark interiors, very short beam spans, heavy construction, and very costly and time-consuming to build, to what we now know as a modern daylit factory, which had very, very long beam spans, was daylit, was fireproof, you could place heavy machinery on the top floors, and this was all very important to the early automakers of the time in Detroit. But what exactly set these factories apart? Surely this had been a desired trait of factories for some time by other industrialists. What did Albert Kahn stumble or invent that allowed him to design factories in this style? Upon digging a little bit to answer this question, I soon uncovered that Albert Kahn had a younger brother, Julius Kahn, who graduated from the Department of Civil Engineering at the University of Michigan in 1899. And soon went to work with his brother Albert. And it was many of Julius's innovations and designs that really were the backbone, were the structure of all of Albert Kahn's factories, as well as buildings here on the University of Michigan's campus. In particular, Julius Kahn patented and pioneered a new system of reinforcing concrete, which was really the backbone of all of Albert Kahn's buildings for the very early parts of the 1900s. This system of reinforcing concrete was a very novel solution and addressed many of the downfalls of early reinforced concrete. And this reinforced concrete method, commonly known as the Kahn Bar, really began my research into Julius and Albert Kahn and industrial architecture. Now, the Kahn Bar was certainly a unique design. It consisted of a main bar with wings bent up at 45-degree angles. This design was really ingenious because it allowed the concrete to really play off its strengths while downplaying its weaknesses. Concrete is very strong in compressive situations, but very relatively weak in tensile situations. So the design of this reinforcing concrete bar allowed for both those strengths and weaknesses to be either exploited or downplayed to the benefit of the concrete, enhancing the strength, durability, and even ease of construction. So upon inventing the Kahn Bar, Julius Kahn soon formed a company called the Trussed Concrete Steel Company, which became wildly successful within only a matter of about 10 years. By 1914, the company was worth over $2 million, which is a huge amount back then, and had its product used in over 15,000 buildings worldwide, Hatcher Library being one of those buildings. Another one of the Trussed Concrete Steel Company inventions that really is found throughout Albert Kahn's works is the use of hollow tile flooring. Now, we can't really observe the hollow tile flooring as it's embedded within the floors and the ceilings of Angel Hall and other such buildings, but we can observe the effects of using this hollow tile flooring. up to this point, floors were pretty thick members of the building, needing to support quite a bit of weight. But with Julius Kahn's invention of hollow tile flooring, this allowed for much, much less weight to be assigned to the floors themselves. As a result, smaller and smaller columns could be used to support the loads of the floors above them. This is evidenced in the Angel Hall entryway here by noting the relatively thin columns as far as diameter goes for the time. Within only a couple years of founding the Trussed Concrete Steel Company, Julius Kahn and other employees of the company soon began to develop a full range of steel building products. This included the staple of the Kahn Bar, but also branched out to be hollow tile floor construction methods, steel window sash, racks for hanging heavy machinery from the ceiling. The list goes on and on. And this is one of the interesting things that my research began to uncover, is just the true extent of the Trussed Concrete Steel Company products. Prior research, it acknowledged the Trussed Concrete Steel Company, but really there's not much out there on quite how far-reaching the products of the Trussed Concrete Steel Company really were. As I said before, they were used in 15,000 buildings around the world within only a matter of years of the company being formed. They were found throughout Japan, Italy, Jamaica, all across the United States, and even used in quite notable buildings. The renovation of the drill room in the Tower of London actually was built with the Kahn bars reinforcing the concrete, as well as Frank Lloyd Wright's Imperial Hotel in Tokyo. Finally, one of the other nice things about conducting this research here on the University of Michigan's campus was really just the proximity of Albert Kahn design buildings on the campus, as well as in nearby Detroit. As I said, there was 19 buildings designed by Albert Kahn on the central campus here of the University of Michigan. But when we go next door to Detroit, and within the city limits of Detroit, there was over 900 buildings designed by Albert Kahn. Sadly, given the state of Detroit, many of these buildings have been torn down or are in a state of disrepair. But as I found, this can kind of be a blessing as well. Given my research into Julius Kahn and his building methods, it's kind of hard to see sometimes exactly the products in the building themselves. You're just seeing the exterior of the buildings. Through the class that was taught by Professor Claire Zimmerman, which I conducted the research as a part of, we took a couple of field trips into Detroit. And the field trips really, I think, tied the research I was conducting together. One of the spots we stopped at was the Packard plant, which is in complete disrepair. Crumbling buildings, falling floors, it's a sad sight. But what this allowed for was I could actually parse through the rubble and actually dig out some parts of the building, such as the reinforcing of the concrete or the floor and the walling material. So between working with the University of Michigan libraries with all of their Albert Kahn material, as well as the actual Albert Kahn firm in Detroit, it became apparent that there's an enormous amount of material, original documents, original architectural drawings, original photographs, available to students such as myself to use. So my hope with this research is that it kind of opens the door for other such research to be undertaken, which I think is particularly meaningful, just given Albert Kahn's prominence to Ann Arbor as well as Detroit. Despite the wonderful resources available through the libraries here at the University of Michigan, none of this research would have been possible without Professor Claire Zimmerman of the Architecture and Art History Department, Professor James White of the Civil Engineering Department, Ms. Sally Bund, a librarian at the Bentley Historical Library, Mr. Donald Bauman, manager of specifications at the Albert Kahn firm in Detroit, and finally Ms. Carol Kahn, Albert Kahn's great-granddaughter, for her many inputs into the family life of the Kahn brothers. Thank you.